So the question is, what was it like for me on the 5th of March? So like most people in New Zealand, I got shaken awake. And actually for me, it was also, you know, some upset family members being awake. So my first focus was kind of really on the family. And I looked at what the event was, saw that it was relatively far ashore, knew that the tsunami panel would be doing their job and working out whether there was any threat. And so I got onto my computer and then went into calculating the earthquake forecast. That's basically like an equation where you put in what time window you are interested in. Say we wanted the first forecast to start at 10 o'clock. For 24 hours, and then usually at the beginning we do like within the next 24 hours, within the next 7 days, within the next 30 days to give people an idea of what to expect. And so I used that model, and on top of that, just because it was derived from parameters in New Zealand, you know, like, but we also wanted to throw in another to just see what the variability would be. We used a model from a global study of subduction zones. We calculated probabilities from that, as well as ranges of earthquakes to be expected. And then I checked those numbers with my colleagues and worked with the communication teams to get that published as a story on the GeoNet website. From the general public point of view, the feedback that we get is that it is really useful to know that this is expected, and also that the number of aftershocks over time decay. So it's quite nice to be able to track that the number's going down. It gives, you know, reassurance that in a way this is normal and it's also passing.
Were the three earthquakes of March 5th related, and what caused them? What caused them is a very basic question, and it goes back to our model of the seismic cycle. In the seismic cycle, we know we have tectonic plates that are shifting around the surface of the Earth. The Earth's crust is moving. The places where these plates come together were accumulating elastic strain. So if you think of a chopstick being bent, if you don't bend it so far that it breaks, it's got elastic strain in it and it'll go back to where it was. If you put a little bit more strain on it, then it can snap, and then the two pieces will go straight, and then you have an elastic rebound and you give off energy, and that's in an earthquake. So the same thing happens when two tectonic plates come together. You can have a release of that elastic energy in a big earthquake. So that's why earthquakes happen at plate boundaries. The link between the earthquakes is a little bit more difficult. We know that if you're very close to two earthquakes, or if you're very close to another earthquake, you're a lot more likely to have a future earthquake. And the mechanisms for that are relatively easy to explain, or we have models that fit in a lot of situations for how that happens. It gets a little bit more tenuous when you think about earthquakes triggering earthquakes at great distance with a bit of time in between them. So if you think of the first and second and third earthquakes that we had, where we might have a few hundred kilometers in between them, then we have theories for why this happened. These theories are hotly debated in science, and the answers aren't conclusive. We've got ideas about how this happens. We know it happens, we see it in reality, but definitively saying why that happened on the day is a really hard thing to do.
Every time there's a earthquake, specifically large earthquakes, you get this big disruption to the stress that's in the crust around that earthquake. So say with the East Cape earthquake, that rupture will have pushed the stress from the colliding tectonic plates, will have pushed some of the stress that was released in that earthquake to the surrounding area. And because of that, the stress goes up in some areas, goes down in other areas, and then the Earth has to sort of settle that stress out. So the continuing earthquakes we see after the larger earthquake are essentially just that stress being worked out by the Earth's crust and the tectonic plates there.
So can we predict what might come after a large earthquake? Now, we certainly can't predict So what we tend to say is forecasting. And the difference is a prediction is, we'd say, deterministic. And we know this is going to happen in this time frame, in this window, in this location. And we just don't have the knowledge and the information to be able to do that. But we can forecast, which in earthquakes, the way we use forecast is that's something is more or less likely to happen in some time frame or space. We talk about clustering. So after an earthquake happens, we know, after a big earthquake happens, we know there are going to be a lot more earthquakes to come after that. And we can forecast that pretty well. I mean, they follow some pretty basic laws. And then there's one called the Omori law that's been around since the 1890s. It's one of the oldest laws in seismology, and it's held up really well. And we use that kind of as just some of the basic information. We add a lot more to that. But we can say roughly how many aftershocks will occur, where they're more likely to be. But an interesting thing is that, and one of the confusions with using the term aftershock is that aftershocks can actually be larger than the main shock. So there's always a probability that something bigger can occur. And we account for that in the information that we put out. So after the 8.1, there is some probability that something larger than an 8.1 can occur. So while we can't predict anything specifically, we can say here are the range of possible things that can occur, and this is how relatively likely each one of those things are.
Okay, so the question was, where are the Kermadecs and why do we have earthquakes there? So the Kermadecs are a group of four volcanic islands located about 800 to 1,000 kilometers northeast of Whakatane. They're joined to New Zealand by about 30 underwater volcanoes, which effectively form a continuous volcanic ridge extending right the way down to Whakatane. Tectonically, the Kermadecs form a subduction zone, which is where the Pacific plate is being subducted beneath the Australian plate. This subduction zone extends beneath the North Island of New Zealand along the Hikarangi margin, and then also extends as far north past Tonga and within 100 kilometres of Samoa. So collectively it's over 3,500 kilometres long. Why do we have earthquakes there? In the broadest sense, they result from the interaction and collision of the Australian and Pacific tectonic plates. Before the plates are even in contact, the Pacific plate starts to produce earthquakes as it starts to bend, flex, and crack before it's subducted beneath the Australian plate. When the plates are in contact, they continue to produce earthquakes, but the largest events are occurred on the interface which forms between them. These earthquakes result from friction, which temporarily causes the Pacific plate to drag or push the Pacific plate in the direction of its motion. When the stress accumulated exceeds the strength of the fault, the Australian plate rebounds and the fault slips, producing an earthquake. So this scenario is effectively what happened in the magnitude 8.1 earthquake last week.
So it's very difficult to say how many aftershocks there are following a large earthquake like the ones that have happened on last Friday, because the way we observe these earthquakes, we don't do it directly, we do it from recordings of the seismic waves. And when we're looking at those seismic wave recordings, we're looking for sort of distinct bits of energy coming in, the kind of pulses that you feel as an earthquake goes on. When you have lots and lots of earthquakes happening in a short period of time, like we get at the beginning of an aftershock sequence, it's hard to say which packet of energy that we're seeing comes from which earthquake. And so when you flip that around, you say, okay, well, how many aftershocks have there been? You're looking at this very murky picture going, oh, is that a wave coming in? Is that a wave coming in? Are they from different earthquakes? You know, that's really hard to say, especially during the immediate period of a response.
The question is, how does GNS monitor earthquakes and tsunamis, and then how do we turn that into forecasts that we can use to keep New Zealand safe and resilient? The answer is a series of answers. First, we monitor the earthquake waves generated before the tsunami hits. We know that about 80% of tsunamis are generated by earthquakes, so it makes sense to use the first information we have about the earthquake to tell us something about the tsunami. The way we measure the earthquake is to look at ground shaking. We have our own instruments across New Zealand, the GeoNet instruments. We also have access to regional instruments in the Southwest Pacific that measure ground shaking from these big earthquakes. When we receive that ground shaking, we determine whether or not we think that came from an earthquake that was big enough and shallow enough to have generated a tsunami. And if we think it has, that triggers a series of other steps. So the first thing we do is we generate, based on that early information, what we think an approximate land threat is in New Zealand, and we push that information to the appropriate authorities as quickly as we can. Once we've done that, then we start looking at the water wave measurements. So after we receive the ground shaking information, then we start to record things like tide gauge measurements when the tsunamis hit coastlines, or dart measurements when the tsunamis travel over some ocean bottom sensors we have, we've recently installed in the Southwest Pacific. When this happens, we measure the wave that travels over it, and then we use these waves, these measurements, to improve our forecasts about what's actually happened and what will happen as the tsunami travels to our coastlines.